acknowledge that the University of Southern California sits on the land of the Tongva, the original land caretakers. We recognize all original peoples of the Los Angeles area and to the north, east, south, and west, whose lands are all connected to where we now learn, work, and live. Susan Silton is an interdisciplinary artist whose projects respond to the complexities of subjectivity in a given moment, often through poetic combinations of humor, discomfort, subterfuge, and unabashed beauty. These works take form in performance, participatory projects, photography, video, installation, text, audio, and print-based works.
Silton's work investigates perception, especially as it relates to subjectivity and subject positions. Her projects are often direct responses to current events, the dynamics of power, and celebrated culture. She is especially interested in the perceptions of celebrity, the accessibility of public space, activism, and coded language. Her work has been presented at MoCA, SF MoMA, Susan Filmada Los Angeles Project, LAX Art, Hammer Museum, ICA Philadelphia, Mass Center for Art and Architecture, and Australian Center for Contemporary Art, among others. Join us in welcoming Susan Silton.
Thank you. got it. Need permission.把咬住。咬住。可以。咬住一开始就想吹，吹下来。
Transformation of silence into language and action is an act of self-revelation, and that always seems fraught with danger. I am indebted to Audre Lorde for these fierce words. It's excerpted from her essay, The Transformation of Silence into Language and Action, which she first delivered as a paper at the Modern Language Association's Lesbian and Literature Panel in Chicago, 1977. Black warrior writer, poet, civil rights activist, lesbian, mother, librarian, her words continue to guide me, anyway. And I'll take them up as a call of sorts throughout tonight's talk. So I wanted to start here. I came across this recently while, researching something else, and I landed on the Wikipedia page for feminism. It's a portrait of Charlotte Perkins Gilman accompanying her article published in the Atlanta Constitution in 1916, What is Feminism? Charlotte Perkins Gilman has been variously described as a feminist, social reformer, writer, lecturer, and humanist. She led what was at that time an unconventional life, divorced from her first husband, bisexual. In the late 1800s and early 1900s, she was a tireless advocate for women's suffrage, for women's economic independence, and known for writing such as Women in Economics, published in 1898, and The Home, Its Work and Influence in 1903, which redefined women's roles in domestic space in economic terms. Quote, "The labor of women in the house certainly enables men to produce more wealth than they otherwise could, and in this way women are economic factors in society, but so are horses." Unquote. A well-known fictional work was the short story The Yellow Wallpaper, whose narrator, a woman suffering from depression and confined to rest cure in a wallpapered room by her doctor husband, chronicles her own descent into insanity. More broadly, as part of the nationalist movement that began in the late 19th century, she championed for socialism and for abolishing class distinctions. Here she's addressing members of the Federation of Women's Clubs in 1916. And yet, this same woman was also a white supremacist, not unlike many other self-avowed feminists and even abolitionists at that time. As Denise Knight details in her 2000 article, Charlotte Perkins Gilman and the Shadow of Racism, in essays such as Is America Too Hospitable from 1923, Gilman says, for example, quote, "The swarming immigrants," unquote, lack the, quote, "progressiveness, ingenuity, and kindliness of disposition, which form a distinct national character," unquote. Gilman complained that the immigrant population was so large that, quote, "I had forgotten what my people looked like," unquote. In her 1908 essay, A Suggestion on the Negro Problem, she says, "We have to consider the unavoidable presence of a large body of aliens, of a race widely dissimilar and in many respects inferior, whose present status is to us a social injury." For what she described as a quote unquote backward race, she proposed a system she called enlistment, in which states could gather, quote, "Negroes below a certain grade of citizenship, who do not progress, who are not self-supporting, who are degenerating into an increasing percentage of social burdens or actual criminals," and proposed sending them to farms, to work on farms. Through this system, which was essentially legalized slavery, she says it is simply state organization of the Negro under conditions wholly to his advantage and therefore to ours. So this is kind of a long-winded windup to my work, but when I came across this on Wikipedia, I thought immediately about context, about how even though Gilman's work clearly impacted various waves of feminism and intersectionality to come, it also speaks to inherent contradictions and the messiness of context, always, which is forever present, forever relevant, and forever unresolvable. And that responding to context, messy as it is, or to a set of conditions, uncomfortable as they are, is really the substance of so much of my work. Whether the context is queer subjectivity or subjectivities, positionality vis-a-vis power dynamics, the framing of histories, the coding of language, bodies altered by disease. With the lens of context in mind, I'm going to focus on a few very recent projects, and I'm going to air tonight, I hope, although celebration took a little long, on the side of not being overly exhaustive. So many projects that are near and dear to me, like Whistling, etc., I won't be touching on, but you're welcome to visit my website and find some of that there. And of course, I am afraid, because as I utter Lord's words over 40 years after she wrote them, I'm living in what feels like a daily nightmare of a time, in a country whose leader epitomizes the worst in humanity, in a world whose peoples are grappling with sustainability and widespread inequality and endless wars. And I am filled with anxiety living in it, because I never thought it could get worse after Reagan. And then I never thought it could get worse after two George Bushes. And because collective memory is so fleeting that past immoral, corrupt behavior is continually forgotten, or worse, forgiven. Because time heals all wounds. Or maybe because everyone loves a winner more than a whiner. So this work from 2015, Sublime Madness in the Soul, is centered and sited downtown. I've lived and have worked in downtown LA since the 1980s. And I moved into this studio building in 2005 on Anderson Street, which became kind of ground zero for the debates centering around gentrification. This is a shot of the facade of 621 Anderson with the 6th Street Bridge behind it. And this is a shot of the building, and you can see in the window, there are a number of windows here. This was my studio right here. This is from the 6th Street Bridge, a shot from the bridge. So a brief few years after I moved in, this area east of the LA River on the border of Boyle Heights and downtown began to transition. And we first really recognized that by the film companies coming in and scouting locations and discovering the raw potential of this industrial space, largely invisible at that time. I took this image of my street when it was set dressed as faux Skid Row for The Soloist, a film from 2008, which was shot at my building and on my street. And this was shot on a Sunday when there was no filming happening. This is an exterior view of the same set dressing with my front door of 621 Anderson. Several years later, galleries began to move in onto the street. New York collector Adam Lindemann opened the West Coast equivalent of Venus over Manhattan, called Venus over Los Angeles, on this corner in 2015, which was the year I ultimately moved. That mural on, I've forgotten the name of the artist who did that mural on the side, but it was after it had been tagged numerous times and Lindemann was, you know, the gallery was very upset about it. Earlier that year, museum as retail space, another gallery moved on the other side of my building, which is on the other side of this picture. So in spring of 2015, I looked out the window of my studio and I decided I needed to finally leave the building. I was really kind of the last holdout there. Many people who had founded the building and started it had already moved. And I felt a need to make a work about all of it, the experience of witnessing this and what that meant to me. So it became kind of a perfect storm of events because the owner of my building sold it. And he was, his grandfather built the building. And I, and then a young hipster art enthusiast from a very wealthy family had been buying up properties downtown and they bought this building. And the 6th Street Bridge was going to be coming out because it was unstable, as you know, it's being rebuilt. And I wasn't quite sure when that was happening, but I felt an urgency to do this. So what I decided to do was to stage, when I looked out at that bridge and I could see the span between the building and the bridge, I suddenly felt an urge to use voice, and opera in particular, as a way in to this subject matter. Opera with a very lengthy history of being political. So I began to create a piece which is called A Sublime Madness in the Soul. And this is a still from that evening. I should go back here. If you can see in the middle of the windows, there's a little board, which was very convenient, and I used that to project a libretto. I didn't put that there, it was already there. And I occupied not just the windows of my studio, but the adjacent studio that had been emptied, and used four windows and four singers. The libretto itself was constructed from excerpts from films such as Wall Street, Do the Right Thing, It's a Wonderful Life, The Great Dictator, Network, etc. And so I constructed those as a very loose narrative in a way. So these films had nothing to do with each other, but the way I constructed the libretto was such that kind of seemed as though it was building in a way to something. Sometimes the singers would end up in one window. The title is taken from American theologian Reinhold Niebuhr's Moral Man and Immoral Society, a study in ethics and politics from 1932, which I learned about from reading interviews with journalist Chris Hedges earlier that year. And Niebuhr, in that essay, cites the necessity of hungering for justice, and that hunger can sometimes look like a sublime madness from the outside, but it should not dissuade one from hungering and from working towards that. These are a couple of stills. And then a couple of
mm-hmm.
So people would walk onto the bridge, and I did not require permits for this because it was on the sidewalk, which made it very convenient. And so people walked onto the bridge from either downtown side or East LA side to a place in the, more or less in the center, where my studio was located, and witnessed from there. There were two performances in one evening, and I invited two musicians per performance to walk onto the bridge from both ends, like around 45 minutes beforehand, and join in the middle in front of the building to play renditions of Depression-era Guthrie-style songs, like Brother, Can You Spare a Dime? So here pictured is on trumpet Clinton Patterson and Alex Wand on banjo. This became the absolute perfect fitting image that I used to promote this work. So while I had been working on the libretto one night, I should back up. There was filming always, like I said, you know, at a certain point it was happening like monthly, it seemed like, and the tenants, we were not very happy about it. But there was one day that they actually did a giant shoot from within the building on the third floor, right across from my studio. They were shooting this piece. I didn't know what they were shooting, and I didn't ask what they were shooting, but I was working on this libretto, and I took a break from it, and I turned on the TV and watched True Detective and saw my building being blown up in the episode that I was watching. So here are a couple of trailers.
Thank you.
This is Juliana Snapper, by the way, who composed a very loose improvisational score. One of the things that was amazing, and again, I'm sorry, I thought I had the right next video, but it isn't. Here it is. Okay. One of the things that was unpredictable that evening that was amazing was that, and I should have known this, but I did not know that on Saturday nights when my performance happened, an East LA car club that usually tricks out between East LA and downtown on Saturday nights was full in force. And they saw the gathering of people. Now, I didn't see this because I was down conducting the singers, but we did catch some of that on film. And the cacophony of the lowriders could not have been more perfect in terms of ownership and property and this gathering on the bridge for this work. So I'll play you a little bit of that.
Oh, want you all to take a look at that sign up there. That sign up there, you see what it says. Cash for your home. You know what that is? It's called gentrification. They buy the land at a low price. They move all the people out. They raise the property value. Then sell it at a profit.
Because opening to love has never come easily. Because what I remember most was the paucity of love. Two people met in a bar, should have stopped at a couple of drinks, and instead made a mess one child at a time. Because speaking certain truths like this one before their time would have felt anathema, ungrateful, a betrayal of life given. Because when one grows up with love gone sideways, the learning curve winds like a steep mountain road in the dark with no end in sight. So in 2010, I had breast cancer, and as one does with one's body and work, you try to make sense of what that is in an aesthetic way, or at least that's how I like to make sense of things, is aesthetically and discursively. One of the first things I did was to look at this piece by Marcel Duchamp, which is called Prière de Toucher, Please Touch. And this piece was made as an edition of 999 copies. It was a book cover wrapping a monograph of surrealist prints, and it was made with the sculptor Enrico Donati. And I guess the very first thing I did was to, I have not actually finished this piece. I don't know why I haven't been able to quite go back to it. This is another view of that with Prière de Toucher, is that I made a painted silicone model of my scar, of one of my scars. It hasn't been finished yet, but I was super interested in how that would translate as a different read for a breast. The other thing I did was to start collecting life drawing books, which I wasn't quite sure at the time why I was doing that. And I still have been collecting them. And one of the things that was very revealing about so many of them, I mean, not all of them, I will be fair, but many of them have very luscious breasts on the cover in poses that are also very gendered. And I mean, in this case, it's like not really even realistic that one's legs would go back like that, you know, and feet be behind you in that way. So I collected a number of books, and also looked through them. Tell me if I'm going too fast. And then one of my favorites is this. So around this time, I met this young queer fashion designer, and I just instinctively jumped in with him and asked him to create a set of costumes for me, striped costumes. And so now I have to take a little bit of a segue into stripes, which is a longer and ongoing project of mine, and which I continue to make work with. So this project began in 2004 with a, and then I'll come back so you'll know why I'm even talking about it. This project began in 2004 with a commissioned billboard, timed to coincide with the election of that year, and many of you guys were too young to probably know what that felt like, but we were looking at another term of the former Donald Trump, George W. Bush. And his first term had already been hugely anxiety producing because of 9/11 and also leading to an invasion of Iraq, which was entirely on false premises. So I was commissioned by Clock Shop Foundation, who was doing a series of these billboards that graced a billboard on top of Wilshire Boulevard, a complex of galleries at that time. And I decided to run with this image that I had found in my archives of a house tented for fumigation and happening to be red, white, and blue, and paired with this word soul, which kind of referred both to the geography of real estate and the timing of fumigations with sales of houses, and also the selling of this country. Soon after this billboard, I found a little book called The Devil's Cloth, A History of Stripes, written in 1991 by French social historian Michel Pastoureau. And in that book, he says, there are a great number of individuals, real or imaginary, whom society, literature, and iconography endow with striped clothing. In one way or another, they are all outcasts or reprobates, from the Jew and the heretic to the clown and the juggler, and including not only the leper, the hangman, and the prostitute, but also the disloyal knight of the round table, the madman of the Book of Psalms, and the character of Judas. They all disturb or pervert the established order. They all have more or less to do with the devil. So the duality of the stripe from its early origins as this marker of otherness, at least according to Pastoureau, and which I've adopted also, to its decorative appeal as a symbol of high modernism has really informed a number of projects past and present that kind of start with that interesting duality and I make work accordingly. So here's a shot of the billboard at night. This was a series of works called Infested from 2005, in which I captured images of houses around LA being tented and put people on the alert to call me so that they were kind of caught on the run. These are large photographs. And there's a whole, you know, set of kind of psychology around infested houses. People feel very shameful about the fact that they have this living thing that's invading their house, termites. And so they are, they're obviously very boisterous visually. And they're also kind of shameful for people. I was invited by the PMCA, which is now closed, Pasadena Museum of California Art, to do a project there. And I half jokingly threw out the idea of tenting their museum, which they loved. Not to fumigate. But it was a very appropriate pairing. This museum was kind of an othering of a museum. It wasn't a collecting museum. It had an interesting history. The people who started it were very interested in Western art, born-again Christians, and somehow we found the funding to get this up, and it was up for a month. And I contracted with a fumigation contractor to hang it in an industrial way with sandbags and pony clips. And the museum was open, during this whole time. And then I've also done other things like this billboard with an embedded text. And this was done as part of an exhibition organized by the Mac Center in 2010 called How Many Billboards? Art Instead. And in this work, I kind of set the stripes consumptive allure against advertising's more ambiguous role in subliminal coding and influencing public opinion. So I'm also, aside from the authorial voice of advertising here, referring to an early Rauschenberg piece from 1961. For that work, Rauschenberg was asked to contribute a portrait of his French gallerist, Iris Claire, to an exhibition of portraits. And he sent a telegram which said, "This is a portrait of Iris Claire, if I say so." So there was both an interest for me in noting the billboard as a kind of conceptual artwork, but also more subliminally intended to foreground the weighted subjectivity of the phrase given Rauschenberg's closeted homosexuality. And mine is hopefully a more staunchly queer counterpart to that, and to Don't Ask, Don't Tell. So I'm also, just want to make a quick mention that I'm very honored to be working on a new commission for a metro station at Fairfax and Wilshire, for which I will also be doing a striped work. And you'll know more about that in the future. So now, going back to life, drawing. I asked Shpatim Zero, who was my designer, to create a series of striped, gendered costumes for me. There, I mean, I could only afford several. So we did a loincloth. We did some black shorts, striped shorts. We did this kind of tutu, if you will. Some high top pants. They were all striped. And while I was in the midst of that, I knew pretty much that I wanted to model. I didn't know how, and I did not know when. And I tend to be super modest, so I was not really looking forward to it. It took me probably 4 years to get up the nerve to do it. But in that time, I've been studying poses, and you can see in this image just how concretized it is, you know, the male poses versus the female ones on the right. There's a kind of closing in, if you will, or frivolousness in a way of female posing, and usually a very active and confident set for men. This kind of, this is more contemporary, but kind of similar in a way. And then I began to look at artworks and posing within those. Obviously, some of these are very familiar to you. And that was, I think, a third century Aphrodite. This is Aang. This is Raphael Mengs. Rubens. And I created a set of five life drawing sessions. I cited them at five different academic institutions, USC being one of them. They were for invited guests, and in each location, a couple of students were also invited from each institution. I did it at USC, UCLA, Otis Art Center, and CalArts. And CalArts actually did not even have a platform because it's post studio, so they had to build me a platform in the art department. A variety of Venuses. Raphael, Boucher. Interesting how so many are clutching a breast. And then a number of odalisques. This is Manet's and Goya. Titian. Disney pretty much nailed the very minimum gestural difference required to define the gendered pose. This is from an older series of mine from 1994, Mutatis Mutandis. Mutation number 8, interactive. These are some of those poses. tried to screw this up, you know, in terms of what I was wearing and what I was posing. Sometimes I didn't, but other times I did. And I did sequences of, you know, 30-second gestures and 2 minutes and 5 minutes and 30 an hour long, and created a sequence for each four-hour session. And I came to these sessions, by the way, just as Susan. I made it very clear that I was not performing, and that they should just treat me like a colleague, a human being. I wasn't looking for anything more than that. One of the things that prompted this project was the confusion I felt about being a lesbian without breasts, to be a dyke without breasts. Soon after I had had my surgery, I ran into a trans friend of mine who had just had top surgery, and he was completely all pumped up and excited about it. And I really screwed with me in terms of how I locate this. What am I? Another situation that happened where a friend of mine, also an artist, had also had breast cancer and had one of her breasts removed. And she was talking to me about what kinds of potential surgeries to have in terms of where they enter my body and how they scar it. And I'll never forget that we were on Skype or something, and she showed me her scar, and she held her other breast. She put a hand over her other breast. And it was so interesting to me that breast was still eroticized and flesh and meaningful, you know, and private. All of these things conspired for me to want to use the abstraction of life drawing and its history to kind of get into this process, discursively speaking. This is a drawing by Tom Mechtel. This is Rebecca Campbell. Lynn Hansen. Neri Gabriel Lemus. Julia Cousins. Alexander Wiesenfeld. This is Alan Brewer. Stas Orlovsky. Trying to give kind of a range of how these turned out. Dan McCleary, and some of the choices that were made by artists. Christopher Chin, chipotle topping. Marilana. Fung Hun. Margaret Lazari. And this is Rafi Calendari. And of course, I'm afraid, because even as queer friends marry, and gender fluidity is a given, and Me Too threw the lid off, and Black Lives Matter keeps naming it, justice feels even more elusive, and truth feels even more threatened. Because social media so often twists language that some fought so hard simply to voice. And because fake news didn't begin in this country with 45, it began with the false narratives we read as children. And of course, I'm afraid because corporations own the art world. Not my art world on a bridge or on a model's platform, but the art world we are told we should aspire to. An art world run amok with money run amok. And the hypocrisy goes on, and I can't bear it, but I too still find myself longing for some glory in the sun before my time on earth is over. So, in December 2009, I came across this call on the internet for a project by John Baldessari called Your Name in Lights. And the setup was this, that anybody could register his or her name on this platform. And the large LED that was going to be affixed to the outside of the Sydney, Australian Museum in Sydney. Once you registered your name on this site, you would be told when your name was going to go up in lights. And these names would be flashing every 15 seconds. And John Baldessari said, you know, we're past Andy Warhol. There's no 15 minutes, it's now 15 seconds. And there was a 24/7 web stream on the site showing the names going up in lights every 15 seconds. So presumably you registered your name and you got to see your name light up many thousands of miles away. And I found that I wanted to do some kind of intervention, use John Baldessari's piece as a way to get at something even more problematic for me, vis-a-vis fame and celebrity and the ways in which names are problematized. These are all things that, you know, images that were accompanying the piece. This is an exterior of the museum. What that kind of looked like. A few years prior to that, I had come across a Wikipedia site of artists who committed suicide. And I was haunted by it for quite some time. It was divided into, you know, I mean, there were even politicians in a particular site, I think, of politicians who committed suicide, but divided into photographers, visual artists, etc. And I was haunted by the fact that the archive even exists, that one would be known or written up as a suicidee. And I was also haunted by how many names I had never recognized on this list. Some of them, obviously, I had. And so I put out a call on Facebook to artist friends and asked if they would be willing to register a name from this site in John Baldessari's piece. One could do that with one's own email, and you could only do it once. So 59 of us registered names in the piece. And I asked everybody to just let me know when those names were going up in lights. And during the 3 weeks that his piece was up, I set my alarm for all hours of the day and night to grab snapshots of those names. And once I had a full set of those names and had a chance to really look at them and sit with them, I realized that I was still very interested in the textuality of the name. You know, if my name is John Doe, what does that do to my life? If my name is Andy Warhol, what does that do to one's life? And so I then set about inviting 11 young art historian writers to rewrite bios for all 59, for actually all 118 artists. And I randomly assigned, let's say, 20 artists to each writer. They were tasked with writing 200 words at maximum about the artist who had committed suicide and the living artist who registered that person. And this became this project called Who's in the Name, which ultimately resulted in a book of bios and the screen grabs. And, you know, all of the writers could approach this however they felt like they wanted to. They could meet with the living artists or not. They could just research online. I was kind of surprised to see how many people did not want to meet with living artists at their studio, and that they just wanted to Google and do the research that way. You know, 200 words is about all one gets if one is lucky in one's lifetime as an artist. So depending on who's writing about your work, you could be the most interesting artist alive, or you could be pretty boring. This is the task of art history. It's the task of curatorial. It's the task of artists as well, taking control of those narratives. So it was an exercise. I then hosted two events, one at MoCA and one at LAX Art. The first one was for artists. They could do 5-minute works however they saw fit in response to the content. Some of them did presentations about the artists they had been paired with and been really poetically inspired by. Others did various other things. So here's a little bit of a clip of one of those.
The name of the structure is the sound of the roads and the names and names and names and names and names. The death of a name is the sound of the end, is before the end, is the sound of the sound of the sound of the name. Of the end, of the beginning, of the sound is of any old name, is the structure of the name, before the sound is the name, or the structure is the name. golden age appears comical and cartoonish on the one hand, but perhaps Alvarez has mysterious association in mind.
Artifex vitae, artifex tui. Mi cerca en mi ocaso yo te bendigo, vida, porque nunca me diste mi esperanza fallida, ni trabajos injustos, ni pena ni merecida. So I'm in the restaurant, and she walks in with her friend, and I'm not going to say we looked exactly alike, but I mean, I was a little taller, and a little broader, maybe it's a little thinner, but I mean, we looked so much alike that people kept coming over to us and saying, are you sisters or are you twins? And we said, we just met.
Looking at George Alt's paintings, I see many of the same scenes transposed through time that have attracted me over the years. And I think about the coincidence that Susan would do this project, and by sheer accident in the draw, introduced me to an artist I've never heard of, but whose images would now always be in the back of my mind.
The person that I was designed by Susan, Robert Bishop, he did finish drawings. And the reason I have this image is because he usually did women that were gagged, they were bound, and they were beaten. And when I was at an exotic dancer in San Francisco, there was a regular I had in gym, he would give me tips with little origamis and things that he would make with dollar bills. And he would sometimes give me prints of Robert Bishop's work.
There's a photographer in New York, it's at brianmoss.com. Before I had thought about it, unfortunately, she was nude bodybuilders. Scott Dick Brother, too, the guy that took ScottBrother.com is also a photographer of hard body views. What the fuck is that all about?
Of course, Vito Arabo is not my real name. It's my porn name. My real name is Margie Shindy. The name on my birth certificate is Margaret Shindy. But I've always been called Margie, just like my maternal grandmother.
I saw the sunset on the lake of fire. It occurred to me this was a place I could retire. Drink to stay cool is the swimming pool and the open bar. There's no simple good or evil. Devil's just like other people.
Because I always looked at domestic violence as something that happened over there, not here. It wasn't with judgment so much as disbelief. Or maybe more honestly, it was judgment. Who in her right mind would stay in a relationship like that, etc.? That's what I thought before. Before police were involved on more than one occasion. No one ever thinks women will be violent with each other. Nearly 50 years after I'd been abused as a child, I walked into a DV group at the LGBT Center, and for the first time in my life, there was a language, a specific language for what had been silenced in me from shame and trauma. When confronted with abusive behavior, I won't shrink like a violet or walk away Gandhi-like. And of course I'm afraid, because from silence into action is a lifetime of lessons learned, sometimes in the hardest of ways. I know that we don't have a hell of a lot more time here, but I do want to get to these projects. Is everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
Are you falling asleep? Yeah? Okay. Have more sugar. So all of these more recent works I envision as a kind of trilogy. In spring of 2016, I was invited by Shamim Momin of Los Angeles Nomadic Division to be part of a series of works she was organizing called Exchange Value. The curatorial project, as stated in the press materials, uses site-specific projects presented over time and space as a vehicle to navigate the current evolution of downtown LA, while exploring broader social concepts such as social justice, value of culture, displacement, local and national politics, gentrification, and more. So leading up to the election, I had planned to extend some of the work I'd done in Sublime Madness into this work, but following the election, I found it very difficult to engage with that content. And very soon after the election, I felt drawn to listen to a piece of music, Olivier Messiaen's Quartet for the End of Time. I'd heard that work before, but I didn't know anything about its history. So I was surprised when I listened to it this time that it brought me to tears right after the election, which led to my discovering its history. Messiaen had been captured and imprisoned as a French soldier at the onset of World War II in Stalag 8A in Görlitz, Germany. He wrote most of the work while he was in prison, and it was performed in the camp for the first time for all of the prisoners. The three other musicians were also prisoners. So Messiaen was a devout Catholic, and he was inspired by a passage in Revelation referencing the collapsing of time into eternity. There will be no more time, as it says in Revelation. He was interested less in the overlay of the apocalypse than a temporal or faith-based one, but the context within which he wrote the piece and performed it fuels its broader narrative and certainly was responsible for fueling my interest in presenting this work post-election. The immediate targeting of Muslims after the election, the systematic targeting since then on the basis of race and gender continues to make, I think, this work really relevant. So I was insistent that the work be presented outside of the context of a concert hall, because music in that setting tends to be very distanced from history in a kind of timeless way. And I wanted to cite the work in an area that had itself had some kind of fraught nature or was contested in some level. So we found this building for sale, and it's actually right next door. Like if you walked out here and you turn left, it's the building right next door, which goes far back to the other street on the other side. This was a montage I made for this work, and it uses an image I found of Stalag 8A with pairing with an image by Dorothy Lange. Manzanar Relocation Center, central photographic file of the War Relocation Authority, both of them from 1942. I wanted to stage the work with all women, so I reached out to pianist Vicky Ray, who is a longtime educator at CalArts, and she plays regularly here and internationally. And she was immediately on board. She organized the quartet of musicians. And I then also had envisioned a very spare choreographic overlay with four dancers. I kind of was seeing the dancers as spirits of the musicians in some way. So I worked with choreographer Flora Wiegman on this part of it. I conceived the stage to be split into two with a scrim in between So a second piano and musicians' chairs were set up both in the back of the screen and in front. And when the piece opens, for example, all of the musicians are in the back and all of the dancers occupy the seats in front. And then lastly, I invited actor Christina Frias to deliver a spoken word mashup of an excerpt from Hannah Arendt's book, Men in Dark Times. So the text reads, even in the darkest of times, we have the right to expect some illumination. And that such illumination may come less from theories and concepts than from the uncertain, flickering, and often weak light that some men and women in their lives and works will kindle under almost all circumstances and shed over the time span that was given them on earth. And I scored this such that it was a very accumulative delivery. So the lights went out, Priya stood up from the audience. She began to recite, even in the darkest times. And then I also had her exchange some of these words for Arabic and for Spanish. The composition is about an hour. This is not, I'm not showing you an hour. And it consists of 8 movements, which alternate in my mind between very resigned or accepting quiet, and then others which are super distressed and frenzied. Here is a brief trailer for that.
Even in the darkest of times, we have the right to expect some illumination.
Thank you.
through these works. You can see this on my site, but I want to skip to the end, even though it would be lovely to talk about it, but we can't be here all night. And of course I am afraid, because I really have nothing to complain about, but I do anyway, and fear being judged. Because I've slept with cancer twice, and always lived with the fear of finding her in my bed again. Because I've disclosed things tonight that I don't typically disclose publicly, and that shit's scary, and people look at you funny. And hardy partiers are infinitely more fun than Debbie Downers. Because it's hard to stay conscious and self-reflective, especially in a time when self-absorption masquerades as self-reflection. Because confidence, like love, also doesn't come easily. Or maybe it's because love doesn't come easily. And because I will always worry what you really think. Of course, I'm afraid because mirrors reveal what you know from the outside, but never really from the inside. Because this is a time gone mad with branded identities, corporatized ambition, and false profits in the form of celebrities. And in such a time, I can only be who I am, naked and raw, wound and balloon, observer and conjurer. And all of that must be its own reward. I'm going to close tonight with this work, which was conceived for and posted on Facebook in the immediate aftermath of the Pulse nightclub shooting in Florida in June 2016. I was feeling pretty powerless that day, and making this work was an affirmation for me of community, of my community, of the queer dancing body, and was intended to both find and hold on to some sense of community.
Thank you.
guys. Thank you for everybody who helped decorate. I know everybody wants to go, but if you have any questions, feel free to ask me or not. So I don't know Sean personally, even though everybody I know knows him. But he's not been somebody I didn't study under him. But I contacted the studio because I knew people who did work for him, and he was fine with it. I mean, he didn't really want our projects mingled. Maybe that would have been different had he known me. But I understood that, you know, so it wasn't like he didn't want to mix them up.
I've seen a lot of these pieces, but I had not seen the What's in a Name performance.
Oh,
show.
Yeah.
And maybe I blanked out for a minute, but what was the connection between those presentations and the Dead?
Oh, so all of the artists who presented that day were part of the book. They had also registered a name in the piece, and their bios were in Who's in the Name. And the kind of construct of that day was that all of the artists could kind of respond to the content in whatever way they wanted at MoCA. So each of them had 5 minutes to do that. Whoever signed on to do it, they could do whatever they wanted. Anything else? Yes.
I just wanted to say how beautiful it was. I've seen most of those pieces actually, but just seeing it put together with that beautiful thread is really moving. Thank you.
I was concerned about that. because I'm afraid. Some of that is just about the age, you know. You saw the little 60-year-old plates. Those belong with a few of us in the room. I think it's much easier because you just have little, you know, you don't have as much to lose somehow. But I would say that the times are so, I mean, I don't know if that's something that younger people really experience, but I think that there's no way to not be vulnerable. It's really screwed up, and I feel like it's important to stay with that as opposed to try to keep it in. You know, Obama would say, don't boo, vote, but you know, so there's that, there's like activism, but there's also just staying open. Because the thing they would want us to do is to close it up. So I feel like, I mean, I don't know, I think other people reading my work would probably, I would be curious to know what they think, if they think it's really vulnerable. I mean, I guess it is vulnerable, but, I think that it's important to me to mix vulnerability with discursiveness, you know, to really have impact. Thank you, guys.
Yeah.